Thank you everyone for joining us here. Very special day for Sabarna Roy, the launch of Abyss, so to speak. But before we do that, we'd like to just have a short lamp lighting ceremony to inaugurate this evening. Please could I ask, first of all, please could you put your hands together for Usha Uthup, the one and only Usha Uthup. Just celebrating 50 years of a career, most of them at Trinkers. Trinkers is celebrating 60 years. And this is the diva who is a Filmfare awardee, a Sangeet Natak awardee, has a... That's it. What's the lamp? Yeah. I'm just going to call the others up on stage. Masayuki-san, if you could have Mr. Masayuki Taga, the Consul General of Japan. Carita and Nick Lowe. Nick is new to the city and we really welcome him. Hope he'll have a wonderful stay here. Thank you so much for joining us. Iris and Jorgen, if we could have you up here, please. Most important, Sabarna Roy, the playwright this evening, who you're going to see in conversation, if we could have you here. Ruma Chakraborty, who will be in conversation with him. This evening would not have happened without three people. Devjani Nondi, who's been the force really behind Sabarna, could we have you here? Mona Sengupta and Shushruto, where are you? Could have you up here, please. Thank you, all of you, for being here. Ladies and gentlemen, just a brief introduction to Sabarna Roy. He's one of those rare individuals who has an insatiable interest in incidents, people, in thoughts, subjects, and his consciousness meanders through places such as Jaipur, Banaras, Tawang, Gulmarg, a whole lot of places, people who move in and out of his life, public figures like Gandhi and Gauharjan, and happenings, movements, phenomena as diverse as the Beatles, capitalism, reservation, Mohsin Kidwai's Mot Smoke, and a lot more. His felicity of words, his language, coupled with his innate perspicacity, helps to make both the mysterious and the mundane very easily graspable by the reader. And he has, with his easy style, his creativity gives vent to a veritable cornucopia of ideas, of genres, such as he has biographical musings, autobiographical notes, he writes fiction, poetry, he writes conversations, and now the psychological thriller. A number of his books, he has five offerings, have been on bestseller lists frequently. And to uncover, delve into why he ticks, what makes him tick, we have Ruma Chakraborty, who has been making English literature more interesting for her students for many, many years, who is venturing into writing herself, who's an artist, a passionate traveler, an inquisitive learner, and in her own words, the archetypal, argumentative Bengali. So please could we have on stage Sabarna Roy and Ruma Chakraborty. Ruma Chakraborty.
Good evening, distinguished guests and ladies and gentlemen. This kind of throws a little spanner in the works because we were assured that perhaps we would have lapel mics, and our hands would be free to gesticulate and wildly do so. However, I would like to begin this conversation with Mr. Roy on the basis of certain understandings of his play and his stories that I've read. And this is highly subjective. Hopefully it should find resonance with some of you. In the words of Soren Kierkegaard, who is a poet? An unhappy man who in his heart harbors a deep anguish, but whose lips are so fashioned that the moans and cries which pass over them are transformed into ravishing music. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
I'm aware that you are a senior engineering professional and you have published complex articles in peer-reviewed national and international journals. And you are also a published author of 5 literary books since 2010. And each of these books have achieved critical as well as commercial successes. So many hats to don, so many personas to juggle. How do you coexist?
First of all, I would like to tell the audience that I'm a bit nervous and edgy. That has been my case in every interview. So what I do is I coax the interviewer to get the first question so that I can make some notes to be able to be prepared for the interview. So as usual, Ruma gave me this first question and I thought to escalate and elevate the intensity of the question, I would make a small note of what I want to transport to the audience through my answer to this question. I'll just read out slowly. My view is modern neuroscience has exposed that human brain is multidisciplinary. Michelangelo and Leonardo da Vinci are brightest examples to elucidate this point. Without Michelangelo, no structural engineer could have imagined the inception of membrane technology in the modern sense, which has roots, interestingly, in a fisherman's net. Da Vinci is credited with the first design of flying air engines, intuitively imagined long back in our epics. With the advent of X-rays, cameras, and moving images, art had to find its roots in a new modernity. Quantum physics dealt with indeterminateness and explicitly impacted social theory and literature. The duality of quantum physics, in a certain sense, took birth 100 years back in the philosophy of Hegel. Likewise, Marxian thought deeply impacted literature. Freud, whose theory of dreams and psychoanalysis was almost demolished during his lifetime, influenced literature and arts in a unique way and continues to do so even today. Well, I'm a trained civil engineer, a discipline that deals with the 4 variables of nature, wind, water, soil, and heat. The wonders of the world would not be possible without path-breaking civil engineering, material science, and architectural imagination working hand in hand. So what I want to say, ladies and gentlemen, is that the divergence is at the surface. Below the surface lies convergence and connectivity of multifarious disciplines. To me, the abyss between liberal arts and technological sciences is a very, very poor social construct, which actually defies anybody's intelligence. Interestingly, as our society is becoming more and more technological, it is approximating the ambiguity and amorphousness of liberal arts. I'm feeling a bit courageous. The next questions I'm going to answer impromptu.
It would be highly amiss of me if I were not to give our audience a glimpse of what I think are sterling examples of his poetry. And I shall read 2 of my favorite pieces from his book, Winter Poems. To begin with, poem number 17. I was awestruck by the face of this boy at Sialdah station. He was looking straight into my eyes, a sharp gaze full of morbid intensity. Surprising was his protruding Adam apple that went up and down mechanically as he sucked into a stick of orange lozenge held firmly in his left hand. He appeared to be a street urchin, a thoroughly abandoned boy with oozing blisters on his hands and legs. He had tens of stringed bracelets around his neck with strange memorabilia, miniatures of ivory horns, plastic goddesses, stainless steel rings attached to each, his rock-cut eyes, Adam's apple, and innumerable bracelets made me wonder. I know him. I know him not. I was in two minds. Number 10 from the same book. In the woods, the leaves are falling. In the woods, the leaves are falling. In the woods, the leaves are falling. From the books, the words are falling. From the books, the words are falling. From the books, the words are falling. From their sockets, the eyeballs are falling. From their sockets, the eyeballs are falling. From their sockets, the eyeballs are falling. The storm that is swelling by the hour is blinding. My question to you, sir, is your first book was Pentacles, which contained a novella and four long narrative poems. It was followed by Frosted Glass, that contained a story cycle of 14 long short stories and a poem cycle of 21 narrative poems. Thereafter, you wrote Abyss, a two-part play, which at its core is a situational thriller, which was followed by Winter Poems, my favorite, and your latest book, Random Subterranean Mosaic, which is a diary or a kaleidoscope of random yet mysteriously structured fiction, the pattern of which is semi-autobiographical and biographical in nature. And it is a summing up of poems, short shots, opinions, observations, conversations. What I would like to ask you is, how do you manage to flip between such varied genres so easily?
I must tell you that I'm not a trained writer per se. I'm, so to say, a very natural author. I don't sit down to write a poem or a prose piece or a play or a conversation. Whatever comes to my mind gets revealed in my mind, I would write. I can give you some successful examples of some of the pieces that I've held over a period of last couple of years, some more than 8-9 years. Clouds of Life from Frosted Glass, which is a long narrative poem. Then the black comedy, The Prank, which contains a lot of meticulous detailing. It revealed to me as a long short story. So it was a short story. Then there was the blasphemous, sexually outrageous, instantaneous death, which I personally feel cannot be written in poetry. It was a short story, very angry short story. New Life was novellic because there was the intruding author, then there was a narrative of the protagonist intertwined. Then you see you have the incomplete conversation set pieces from Random, which you yourself described at the book launch in Oxford. Winter Poems, Abyss. So I have written various kinds, not because I thought that I want to be a very varied writer. In fact, my subjects have been very limited, if you see. My subjects have been very limited because my first-hand experience in life is also very limited. But yeah, genres, yes. I have been authentic to the way things have revealed to my mind. That could be my answer.
Yes, it has been very illuminating. You write a lot about betrayal, love, loss, defeat, wasting in human relationships, which almost bring us to the brink of a postmodern crisis. Moreover, at times your writings are sexually explicit, which can put off purists. Do you feel these things very deeply as you write?
Now, you are a reader of my book. You have to tell me whether I write deeply or not, because I may be saying I write very deeply, but you don't feel the depth or the intensity. It doesn't make any sense, my saying so. But the only answer which I would like to give is, you see, I am a product of a time.
Right.
So, and I am always writing in the present tense. I'm not writing like a historical magnum opus like what Amitabh Ghosh writes. And I'm also not a chronicler of a city like the Istanbul writer Orhan Pamuk, although Calcutta features in my writings in a very major way, because this is a city which I love to stay, which I love to live, and which I would love to die in. So what I am saying is, betrayal, loss, defeat, whatever I see in the characters and events around me, I write about those. Whatever I see, and moreover, I don't think I can be portrayed as an author of hope or hopelessness, because I don't think in binaries, terms of binaries. So whatever I see, I mean, like somebody said that instantaneous death is, although it's sexually blasphemous, even today when I read, first time I didn't want my children to read that book, that story. In fact, I was also ashamed when I read out that story to some of the audience long back in 2008. But interestingly, transgenders in Badu liked that story very much. I was lauded like a rock star there. But a lot of people have said instantaneous death gives us a lot of hope in a metaphysical way.
Right.
So you don't write about positives and negatives. You write about what you see. You copy from life. That's all what you are doing without taking sides.
Okay, an impartial writer. Your writing style is also very consistently lucid, and there is an avoidance of adverbs and adjectives. You also write open-ended pieces, something I wish our children could. Therefore, how do you bring about this balance of not using a lot of, you know, these words that pepper your...
You see, long back when I was in Jadavpur University, we had very good teachers in the English, Bengali and the comparative literature departments to tell us that please avoid adverbs and adjectives and write the use of proper articles in a sentence. And of course, the grim sense of grammar in a language was drilled in my head through Renan Martin by my mother. So yeah, I mean, very early on, I started writing in small sentences. At times I would write also in long sentences, but avoid adverbs and adjectives. And one of the great things I would say is that, you know, I would feel very defeated if a reader comes up to me and tells me, I did not understand what you wanted to say in Abyss. I want to communicate with people, with my readers. So I know that to be able to communicate, you have to lucidly express the complex things around you. To go beneath the agendas of cells, groups, and communities. And, of course, the powerful, the crimes that are unleashed on the powerless. Yeah, that's my answer.
a writer who would go a long way in reaching everybody's hearts. You are also a self-proclaimed atheist. And yet, when the reader reads your books, there is this deep spiritual sense that pervades it all. What do you ascribe this to?
Well, I don't know whether my wife will like this, my saying this, that, you know, I have been suffering from alternative bouts of melancholia since my early childhood. And melancholia, in some sense, you know, brings you very closer to also metaphysics. Maybe people feel the spiritual sense because of that. I personally, I would ascribe to, because a lot of readers have come up to me and said this. But I'm not a pure atheist also, because I do think that my children are my gods.
A vegan atheist, okay. We move on to our next question. I would like to also comment that you are very equitable with your male and female characters, and also characters with very complex sexual choices, like Rahul, King Chuk, Nina, Nandana, Rohini and Gabbar. And all of them are very deeply etched and very beautifully woven into the texture of your narrative fabric. And yet, it is necessary for the author to be slightly detached from what he is writing. How do you bring about this balance, even though they are so...
People who know me closely, you know me a bit. I think you will agree that I'm not a sentimental or an emotional person per se. In fact, I hate sentimentality in every form. And I don't look at any phenomenon, as conflicts between an alleged perpetrator and an alleged victim. You know, political groups take sides. An artist or a writer is free. He's a free agent or a free radical in many senses, but also he's not free. There are some of my friends who will catch me by the neck while sipping a whiskey later on, that how can a writer be free? He cannot be. Yeah, he cannot be, I agree. But in many senses, he is free. So he needs to take a detached view of circumstances and characters so that the mystery or the secrets behind phenomena are exposed. Yeah, that's it.
I think I'm going to ask on behalf of our audience here, what are we to expect from a dramatized reading session of Abyss?
You see, Abyss is a situational thriller with an unnatural death, some bit of sex. So we can expect some juicy entertainment. And of course, there are very serious issues behind the play. But yes, a lot of politics, a lot of suspense, a lot of investigation, a lot of sleuthing, everything you can expect. And I definitely think Spotlight is going to do a very, very good job, because I have a lot of confidence in them.
Before we go into Abyss, with your permission, I would like to read out chapter 9, which is essentially two pages of printed material from The Last Plunge, which is a short story from Frosted Glass, to showcase to the audience how you flip through the genres in the matter of a single chapter of the same story. To my mind, it's a brilliant example. Do I?
Yeah, please. Please.
A few days back, Rahul visited a remote mountain station covered with cedar, chinar, maple, and deodar trees. He stayed in a small cottage surrounded by brightly colored wildflowers. The sunshine was pale. The sky was a mixture of colors, ultramarine and gray. At night, he walked through the dimly lit alleys, searching for something, but he could not remember what he sought. he was perplexed and vexed. During one of his nocturnal expeditions, he came to a playground lit on all sides. It was crowded with people sitting in zigzag rows, looking attentively at a raised podium where a play was being enacted by a group of young, energetic men and women dressed in strange, colorful clothes. He could see that the play was serious in content, but it was entertaining too. Once the play was over, a serious-looking gentleman in traditional mountain clothes announced in a deep baritone, "Now, ladies and gentlemen, we've come to the last part of our program. We proudly present before you a woman who survived death in the most infamous epidemic that ravaged the eastern parts of our country a few years back. She is presently under rigorous medical investigation by the National Institute of Virology. Doctors and specialists believe she could be holding secrets in her blood, secrets dealing with life and death. The medical fraternity is spellbound by the way she has defied death. She is a poet of great merit and has agreed to read out one of her earliest poems. Ladies and gentlemen, I present Rekha Datta Gupta." A few seconds later, Rahul saw a small woman on stage. She wore a white sari with a cobalt blue embroidered border. She had large black eyes in a beautiful face. She looked at the audience almost reluctantly for some time and then began in a low, soft voice. "There was a man who was in love with me. This was a long time ago. While I was deeply moved by his silent love, I was helpless. I was already engaged to another man who was a friend since my college days. However, I was so touched by this man who loved me silently that I followed his life closely. A few years later, when I was already settled in my married life with two sons and a creative career, I wrote a poem entitled Missing Rahul. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll read out this poem to you now." Rekha paused briefly, then recited the poem. "This mask will go away this year. That mask will go away that year. These are the words Rahul's ma remembers Rahul had said when he left home 2 years back. Where has Rahul gone 2 years ago, never to come back home? His ma says, Rahul did not talk to me after those words. Between this year and that year, between there are other years. Between this mask and that mask, there are other masks. Between years and masks, Rahul has held the scent of his ma's bosom, the shimmering shadow of a gun, Nanu's fragile fingers, the yellowing photograph of Rupa, who never came back after making it in Tinseltown, Rangamashima's spasms between his legs, the Krishnachura tree where they played hide and seek, fried malpuas dipped in jelly on a cloudy autumn afternoon. And then, tired of holding all these, Rahul withdrew his hand one night and let matters fly and fall. I could not meet Rahul even in oblivion. One evening, as I opened my email box, I found a message from him that goes like this: Nanu, you believe the sky is blue. I believed the sky is blue. But Nanu, sky is space, and space has no color. When the masks are gone, the man does not exist for you. You do not see him, though he is breathing down your neck. Only silently, unrelenting space falling from within the cups of your palms." Once the poem was over, there was a huge round of applause, and everyone got up to gather around Rekha to ask her how she had survived the epidemic. Rahul moved out of the area dazed. He walked, immersed in his haphazard thoughts, till he reached the edge of a deep, expansive gorge, which in the darkness of the night looked like an expansive gorge opening its secret doors to the center of the earth. He was suddenly taken over by an overwhelming desire to feel the depth of the gorge. He jumped like a thunderbolt, Rekha's voice ringing softly in his ears. Before we move on to the presentation of the dramatized reading session, sir, would you like to add a few words?
I would briefly like to make a statement and a dedication note. The statement goes like this: Orhan Pamuk, a few months back, made a seminal speech at the Columbia University on what writers should write about, the postmodern writers should write about. So I actually wrote two lines thinking of that. With reference to our context. The horrors of partition on both fronts gave us sparkling literature and arts. Similarly, NRC, National Register of Citizens, in the next 10 years, I believe, will give us equally sparkling subject of a new kind of rootlessness to explore in a new dimension. Interestingly and ironically, the powerful always gives us, we writers, subjects to write on when we are almost on the brink of thinking that we are going to end up with subjects. So in India, I think we have a new topic to write about. And as far as the dedication goes, I think from my side, I need to make a dedication and I need to see the slip, I don't want to antagonize my wife by not taking her name. I dedicate this evening's event from my side to Baba, who is here, Devjani and my children. I'm thankful to Tista, my daughter, for having flown into Kolkata for this event today morning. And Bholu, my son, who is slogging through his work in London now. I would have loved if my sister and her husband and Lal and Shilpi were here. Ma and Devjani's parents would have been very proud to have seen me here today. But they're not here. What can be done about that? And two persons I would like to name who have been like rock anchors for this event to happen. One is Mr. Swaroop Nanda of Lead Start Publishing. He's the CEO of Lead Start Publishing. He's also a personal friend of mine. And of course, Miss Wendrila Dutt. If Wendrila Dutt was not here, I don't think she would have, this event would have been possible. She made very critical interventions at the right time to make this event, and I would like to tell her that Devjani and I would do anything to make her happy. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Ruma.
That was a wonderful thank you. Thank you, Ruma Sabarna. And this is going to be Abyss, coming on stage now, presented by Spotlight. They've really been stalwarts of English theatre in the city. Three of my favorite actors, part of Spotlight, Pradeep Mitro, Rita Roy, and Poonam Singh. Just before we get into the reading, the dramatized play reading, a brief introduction to the characters. Debusri, chief promoter of the Lahiri Group of Companies, and Oindrila's mother. I hope that Oindrila isn't one of the wicked ones. I don't know. It would be so out of character, so don't laugh, Preetidi. Oindrila, chemical engineer, diploma holder in business management, and heir apparent to the Lahiri Group of Companies. Mriganko, writer, Oindrila's love interest. Lolita, Oindrila's first cousin, and employed in the Lahiri Group of Companies. Oyon, also Oindrila's first cousin, and working for the Lahiri Group of Companies. We have another Oyon here. Devi Babu, Debusri's man, Friday, in the company. Shomuresh, IPS officer, and Renuka Sanyal, ex-IPS officer, currently a detective. This is going to be almost exactly 1 hour, and before the play starts, I'm going to invite Poonam Singh to give you a brief introduction to Spotlight. Poonam. We have the lights out, please.
Spotlight is Calcutta's well-known English theatre group that has to its credit several full-length productions and dramatized readings in prestigious venues in the city, and now, for the first and hopefully not the last time, at the JW Marriott. A very big thank you to Oindrila Dutt, Sabarna Roy, and Ahava Communications for giving us this opportunity. A big thank you to the JW Marriott for this beautiful venue and all the help extended by their staff. Dramatized readings is a genre wherein we use our scripts but also have sound, lights, and music for dramatic effect. Ladies and gentlemen, may we once again request you to please keep your phones on the silent mode. Spotlight presents an edited version of Sabarna Roy's play, Abyss. The drawing come dining room of the Lahiri house. It is early evening.
How long have I been waiting for your ma, tell me, huh? Was she serious when she said she wanted to meet me?
Of course she was dead serious and is. Don't get impatient, darling.
How long have I been waiting here, you tell me? It's already 2 hours that I've been waiting here for her.
You sound as if you're waiting at the railway station. If you're so sporting enough, you can tell me all about the latest book that you're writing.
Meeting your ma is a job that has to be done well. I'm trying my best to keep myself alert. I don't want to be distracted. I fear my performance could suffer.
You are very, very tense.
I am.
Why? She's definitely not a monster.
Frankly, that's the image that I've got of her from whatever I've heard from you. She's on your nerves, and now she's on my nerves.
How can you say that? She's not on my nerves. Never. Well, she has her ways of pushing me through difficult things. That's because she wants me to succeed in life.
I'm a bit uncomfortable. As if I'm going to give up my sovereignty, laying myself up to outside scrutiny. You know, the first time you told me about meeting your ma and seeking her approval of me, I thought of giving you up. Yes, seriously. I hated this idea of approval in love and consensual marriage and live in whatever.
Well, what made you change your mind? Go on, I'm listening.
I understood how important your ma is to you.
Well, she's making the task for her and for us more difficult so that the reconciliation is all the more pleasing. You know, satisfying.
Unfortunately, I do not share that view, okay? And she thinks I'll be wrong influence on you.
She'll change her mind once she meets you. I'm sure of that.
The question is, if she disapproves of me, what will you do, huh? Will you cancel me out, abandon me,
Such a situation cannot arise. Don't be cynical. I am her daughter. She has always stood by me. She'll not play with my happiness.
Your ma's an interesting character from a writer's perspective. She's mostly been firm and daunting on challenging occasions. What excites me to know are those unknown incidents in her life where she's been weak, fragile, and vulnerable.
I cannot believe that she's been weak, fragile, or vulnerable ever. I just cannot. What should I make of a woman who was married off at the age of 16, became a mother at the age of 18, lost her husband at the age of 24 to a gruesome road accident, was on the verge of being thrown out of her in-law's home, and fought within the family for her rights? She took care of the children and family as best as she could. Tell me, Mrigangku, what should I make of such a woman?
I'm only saying that there are a few holes, invisible and unseen, that will help us complete the picture. Mm. But that's not required. I'm not saying for a moment that she has not been remarkable. But does it give her the right to infringe on my life or yours?
She's absolutely within her rights, damn it. You are just, you know, guessing all this.
How anxious is she? Tell me. She's not even excited to meet the love of her only daughter. She has made a judgment even before meeting me.
Stop it. In such a situation, I'll have to choose between my ma and my man.
Wrong. You'll have to choose between your inheritance and your man.
You've been too lonely and away from a family to know the intensity of love that exists between parents and children. At times you ridicule it because I suspect you believe the intensity is hyped and overplayed. But I know one thing for sure.
What?
That you'll guard me from unhappiness, won't you?
Why are you asking? You said you're already sure about it.
Sometimes I doubt whether you will.
You doubt me?
No. It's only a fleeting thought. I fear I'll lose you.
I love you. You are my anchor, my passage to everything brighter in life. If I lose you, I'll die.
You will never lose me. I love you so much. Ma has arrived. At last, I hope you'll do everything in your capacity to win her heart.
Yes, I will.
Life is beautiful.
Later in the evening, after dinner.
Mrigangku, you're a small eater, I must say. Didn't you like the food?
Generally, I don't eat such elaborate meals. The food was very good, very delicious.
Oh, I see. But how elaborate is elaborate? I mean, you're a young man, you should eat more.
You know, in the morning before Ma left for office, she had herself ordered each and every dish to be prepared for the occasion.
Wow, it's a truly satisfying feeling, I must tell you.
Ma?
Yes, dear?
You look disturbed. Is there anything that's bothering you?
Yes, you see, I had a horrible meeting in the office today. And I need to talk to you, actually.
Sure, come on, let's talk.
No, we can talk later. Let's talk to Mrigangku first.
I think I need to make a move. I'll come some other day.
No. Mrigangku, please sit down. Ma, I want you to talk to me in his presence. Right. Do you have anything disagreeable to talk about him?
No, not really. I mean, I need to talk to you about a few recent developments in the company. Do you want me to sort of tell you all these things in his presence? Things that might show your paternal family in poor light?
I have not hidden anything from Mrigangku. He knows mostly everything. Yes. Okay. There's nothing to hide from him. Right. Ma, I insist.
All right then.
I think you're being very unfair on your ma, Indrila. I'm going for now. I'll come back this weekend if you like.
No, Mrigangku, please don't go. Please sit down. And I think I can talk to her in your presence. Please excuse this scene.
I don't mind at all. I think you are being very reasonable, ma'am.
Thank you.
Tell me, ma, what's on your mind?
Well, Oindrila, it seems Lalita, Oyun and Devi Babu are teaming up against you.
Mrigangku, Lalita and Oyun are my cousins. And yes. Devi Babu is my ma's man Friday. Okay. A long time associate in the company since my father's time.
Okay. Mrigangku, I'm trying to form a new company, you see. And my idea is Oindrila should get associated with me in this project and get to know all the details of this project. I want it to be a small family team, actually. Oindrila, the two senior engineers, Devi Babu and myself. Hmm.
Where's the hitch then? I find it a very well-done heist.
You see, I was talking to Devi Babu and he expressed doubts about Oindrila's inexperience.
Does this Devi Babu no envelope. Oh,
of course he does. From the day she was born. But I have issues with Devi Babu, you know, about his views on Indrila. And he thinks she can't succeed as a professional promoter in any new business. Unfortunately, though, the perception is strengthened by Indrila's love for a not-so-successful writer of stories and poems.
Ma, is that the issue then?
No, that's not the most serious issue, honey. What makes my blood boil is Devi Babu's covert move to up the case for Lalita and Oyun. Well, they're doing okay as professionals, but they've nothing in them to become effective business leaders. I can see that clearly.
I'm getting attracted to this fascinating narrative. Ma'am, can I ask you two questions?
Yes, of course.
Why should this Devi Babu support Lalita and Oyun and not Oyunrila? And are you sure of Oyunrila's capabilities as a business leader?
Before that, I have one question. How sure are you that Devi Babu does not want me in this new business?
Well, you know, Devi Babu has suggested that I consider putting you as an apprentice in the existing business and put Lalita and Oyun as supporting executives to me for the new business.
Do you think Devi Babu is alone in this, or Lalita, Oyun and he are together?
You know, in the last 6 months, Lalita and Oyun have been consistently fishing for information on the new company and meeting up at the strangest locations. After I declared that Oyunrila was going to be joining the company last month.
So what do you plan to do now?
Well, more importantly, what do you plan to do now?
Well, at this moment, I'm seeking your approval of Mriganko.
Ah, well, you're insulting your lover by seeking my approval of him in his presence. It'll hurt a writer's ego, you know.
Ma, I must assure you that after I join work, I will do everything in my capacity to keep plotters at bay. I'm sure you and I can achieve our objectives jointly.
Yes,
but
we
Ma,
can.
But Ma, you should not insult Mriganko.
No, I'm not doing that. I'm happy that you attach so much importance to my approval, but if you think you must get my explicit approval, then I must see equal love for you in his eyes.
Madam, I'm impressed by the way you've put it. You've tacitly put the onus on me. You must know this for sure. Had I not loved your daughter immensely, I would not have agreed to join this approval circus for once.
Nicely put. Mriganko, I have a few issues to discuss with you. Is it too late for you now?
No, of course, we can talk if you want to.
Right. Okay, then. Oyunrila, could you please excuse us? Give us a bit of privacy. I can't talk to Mriganko in your presence.
All right, I'm going. Mriganko, I'm going to my room. Before you leave, let me know.
Yes.
Ma.
Yes.
I'm not going to ask him what you both have discussed. I hope you'll believe me.
Oh, yes, of course, dear. Huh?
Okay, good night.
Good night. Mriganko, are you writing anything at present?
I'm working on a short novel. It's at the planning stage now.
I see.
I'll start writing within a month or two.
And how many books have you written so far?
Six.
Six? Yet you've not been able to get any big publisher?
Madam, my books are published by a group of my friends who believe in my work.
I see. And you don't aspire to publish with a reputed publisher?
I do, but I don't know how I should go about it.
I see. You know, I've read two of your books.
And I'm sure you didn't like them.
Well, I thought they were rather strange and at few places quite distasteful.
You sent Oyunrila away.
Yes.
What do you want to discuss with me, madam?
I wanted to tell you that my view is you're not the right match for Oyunrila.
I've not given you the right to decide that, please.
It's because of you that she'll fritter away her life. Tell me, what do you see so lovely in her that you have to stick to her?
And what do you see in me so ugly that you must shun me away?
You're a small-time writer, Mriganko. If you marry my daughter, you win everything. A beautiful and intelligent woman and access to her inheritance. And what does she get, huh? Absolutely nothing. The fact is that I'm not happy with this relationship. I'm sure you don't love my daughter as much as she loves you.
I'm tired of facing this inquiry.
Oh, another thing. You had an affair with a married woman that lasted for 3 years before you started romancing my daughter, and then you went and ditched her.
Anything else that you know about me?
No, nothing worth mentioning except that you invest traditionally and don't gamble in shares and mutual funds, which is a good thing, actually.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
You're not seriously concerned about the trio of Lalita, Oyon and Devi Babu, right? You can oust them away any day you like. What worries you most is how capable Oindrila is for the job you've carved out for her and how maneuverable her lover is, huh?
Oh, I want this meeting to end right now. It's already quite late, you see.
Going out as soon as I can.
Yes.
And please inform Oindrila on my behalf.
I will do that.
Thank
you. Good night.
A few days later, in the evening.
Can you tell me what are you upset with? You've not talked to me normally since the day I visited your ma house.
I didn't expect you to leave my house without informing me. I had clearly told you that.
I'm sorry, honey. I'm sorry. I made a mistake. I won't repeat this in future, all right? How is your work going on? Are you liking it?
Yeah, exciting stuff. Ma also introduced me to the bankers and the proposed equipment suppliers.
And did you meet Lalita, Oyon and Devi Babu?
Yes, Devi Babu is there all the time. He's practically guiding me in every effort. I met Lalita and Oyon twice.
You felt anything cooking up between them?
Not really.
You don't believe what your ma is saying, right?
I won't say that. If she says that they are ganging up against me, I'm sure they are. She must be in the know of deeper things which I am not.
So, are you in awe of your ma?
I am. You know that. But I want her to slow down over a period of time and reach out to her other sensibilities.
I don't think she can ever slow down. These kind of people die on the battlefield.
Don't talk about death, Mriganko.
I was only making a point about people who love to be powerful because they've succeeded in one battle after another and they're sucked up in the wind of power.
You think Ma's power crazy?
You would be dumb to believe otherwise.
You think Ma is making up stories about Lalita, Ayon and Devi Babu?
I'm not sure, but I have my doubts. If I had the power, I would like you to move away from your company to do something independently.
Why?
Because I think your company is not your calling. You are just not fit for this kind of work. That is not where your happiness lies. That war will kill your soul. And to avoid a war, you must not participate in it in the first place.
Is that so? Or you believe that if I succeed in my new company with the active support of my ma, I will become big, too big to handle. And that seriously hurts your male ego, isn't it? So you try to convince me to leave it in the name of independent work. Don't try to brainwash me. I have a brain of my own.
That's precisely what I'm saying. Use it to your best advantage, please.
Anyway, you didn't tell me finally what happened between you and Ma that night?
She asked me a lot of questions.
Okay.
Yes, questions like, she asked me whether I planned to write a crime thriller ever. I said I would in sometime in the near future. And she asked me whether I was opposed to publishing with a big publisher. I said no, if I got a break, I would, definitely.
Then why did she ask for a private meeting? I want to know, what was the necessity for me to go? You're not telling me something.
You want me to fabricate something to satisfy the queries in you, huh? Of course, she asked me about my family and my past affairs too.
Did you mention your affairs to her?
Yes, I did.
How did she take it?
She took it with a very straight face. At least, that is the impression that I got.
Anything else worth mentioning?
Not that I can think of immediately. She didn't tell you anything about any impression I made on her?
She told me something strange last night.
What?
That I should keep you as a friend and a confidant and marry somebody else.
Another day, late after midnight.
Yes, I did. I needed to talk to you, Riganko.
Well, what is it?
I'm exasperated, you know. It's been 7 months since Oindrila joined the company and the work is getting completely delayed because of her questioning.
What has happened?
Oh, you know, she's not happy with the land deal. She's not happy with that the peasants have not been compensated enough. And she questions the project and, you know, about the cost that had the brokers, the bankers, and the dealers have all been approved of. But she asks me why, you know, why we're doing this.
She also questions me on many things.
Really?
Yes.
Like what?
Like, why would you open a publishing business all of a sudden? Why am I publishing my new book with you and ditching my core group of friends?
And what did you tell her?
I told her it's my life. Regarding your publishing house, I've urged her to put that question to you.
Riganko, if you tell her, speak so brashly like this, then she'll know that you don't love her anymore. You know, were you ever in love with her? When did you stop loving her?
Since the day she started intuitively realizing that I don't love her anymore, mm-hmm. She became a prisoner of melancholia.
Oh.
You know, this is a strange disease. Melancholia clears up your mind and shows the darker side of the truth. And then you do not know what to do with it. True. Today she can see through your lies.
What lies?
Lalita, Oyun, Devi Babu.
Oh, come on, Riganko. Lalita, Oyun, and Devi Babu are still working against Oindrila. And they're brimming with joy that she's failing in all the objectives of the new company. Riganko, what do I do with Oindrila? I've no control on her. My word is no longer the last word. I feel like dumping everything.
Including Oindrila.
Oh, no, come on. Why would I want to dump her? Why would I be worried if I did not care for her?
I was not making a comment. I was only asking.
Ah, I see. You taunt me because you seem to have the power, right?
What power do I have on you? Huh? You're going to be my publisher soon?
And that's because I wanted to compensate you for your effort you'll have to make to move away from Oindrila. But then you stopped loving her anyway. So... I've called you here today to ask your advice on Oindrila. What should I do to stop her from sinking any further?
The situation needs understanding.
Yes, I know.
You have to allow Oindrila to be what she wants to be.
No, but then that will cause a furore, an absolute disaster. I must rein in my daughter. And also, I have very serious fears for her.
What fears?
You see, Oyun's father had murdered two of his concubines in a fit of rage because they had demanded money even after he stopped visiting them. So you see, murder runs in their blood. Lalita and Oyun's. You know what I mean?
Mm. You think Lalita and Oyun could be plotting to kill Oindrila?
Yes, why not? They're jealous of her. I've witnessed that in their eyes since their adolescent years. And they assume dangerous proportions when tutored by an assassin like Devi Babu.
Then why don't you simply throw them away?
Oh, no, 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 I can't do that, you see. I couldn't have taken control of the business without the support of Devi Babu. He knows secrets that will die and get buried with him. I accommodated Lalita and Oyun as a means of implicit truce, but you know, no truce can be one-sided, as you know. Everything was going on fine until you arrived.
You overestimate this cause of turmoil.
No, I know my daughter. She started losing it when she fell in love with you and took her affairs so seriously that she forgot her own good. She forgot that this dream maker is looking for a comfortable parking lot and is not anywhere near close to what she thinks him to be.
You know what? You make greed look so sexy.
Oh.
So I thought it better to toe your line. Everything was going on fine in my life until you arrived.
Oh, come on. Shut up, Mriganko. Listen, I have a plan.
What?
I want you to marry Lalita because, you know, I'm afraid that you'll come back to Indrila someday.
You think marriage is a strong enough citadel to stop me from returning to anybody I feel like?
Well, marriage may not be, but I am. Listen, I'm planning a party next Saturday and I'll use this gathering to lift up Oindrila's spirits as much as I can. And I want you to devote your time in seducing Lalita, all right? I believe Oyun has been wanting to produce this movie and he's discussed it with you, so I'll fund you from behind. Unfortunately, Oyun won't be there that day because he's traveling, but I want you to bring this brother-sister duo far out of the clutches of Devi Babu.
And what happens to you?
What happens to me? Hmm? Well, I remain in the center of the universe as always.
Next Saturday, a party scene.
Let's meet our guests. Ah, Devi Babu, you're already here, I see.
Early as always.
Yes, most welcome.
I'm so excited.
Yeah, you?
I've never met a writer in flesh and blood before.
Oh, really? Well, I do understand your excitement, you know. You know, meeting writers is so exciting, especially a good one like Mriganko. And, you know, we're always afraid that they'll get underneath our skin. I'll be back in a minute.
I read his first book. Oindrila had given it to me.
Oh.
I found it quite interesting. Nice English, quite visual at places. But they're not straight-cut stories, you know. They are punctuated at times with philosophical discourse.
Ah.
Very modern, I must say.
Yes. Ah, here's Mriganko.
Oh,
welcome.
There you are.
Mriganko meets Devi Babu.
Hello.
And this is Lalita.
Hi. I may sound a bit over the top. You know, I've never met a writer before, Mriganko. Do you go for book readings and poetry launches as well?
Yes, at times I do.
Oh. Lalita, are you aware that we're publishing his next book? We'll reprint all his old books. We'll launch him in a massive manner. You know, the ex-speaker has agreed to come to the book launch.
Ah, and how big is the fiction market, Bodhi?
Well, not really very big. I mean, what sells are cookbooks and health books, spiritual and travel books.
Quite true.
But before we launch Mriganko, we've planned to bring out two books of each category by well-established guys. So that our publishing house makes a niche for itself, you know, and then we launch him.
What is your next book about?
I'll not tell you the exact plot, but it's a contemporary story set in the suburbs of our city. Mm-hmm. About a Bengali family getting slowly decimated.
I see.
Culturally and financially, of course. This time it'll be a straight cut narrative.
Oh, something in the style of Sharad Babu?
Somewhat, yes.
JT Ma?
Yes, dear.
Where's Oindrila?
Yes. I think I have
Look,
to go.
Look, I was just going to ask you that. I just brought a bottle of red wine for her.
Oh, did you?
Oh, it's a pity Oindrila isn't with us today. You know?
Yes,
we are missing
I know.
Him. We are missing
I know.
Him.
Well, I'll go and look for Oindrila. I think she's getting ready and she said she was almost ready. So, where's the bottle?
Over there. Malbec.
Right. Thank you.
When you say
Yes.
What interests you the most, Lalitha?
Oh, I love traveling. I travel all over the world. Mm? But you know, I can't stay away from Kolkata too long, which is my home.
And what kind of places do you love the most?
Oh, blue water, splashing on white beaches.
Okay.
Oh, I love running around those places. You know, sometimes I think I'm going to reach the end of the world and my tasks would go unfinished.
You have lots of tasks to finish, right?
Oh, yeah. She's a very determined young woman, Briganko, and very capable.
I can see that in her eyes. You've brilliant eyes, Lalitha.
Will you please excuse me? I'll just go and find out where Bodhi and Oindrila are.
Yes, of course, please. So tell me, how often do you travel, Lalitha?
Twice a year. Do you travel a lot?
Not much really, but I need to see the world.
Oh, I can take you to some of the world's best beaches.
Be my guide. You don't love mountains, do you?
No. I like the sea compared to the mountains. Do you like mountains?
Yes, of course.
What do you see in my eyes?
Come again?
You only said you can see it in my eyes.
Oh, yes, sir. Unfettered beauty and unbridled ambition, a heady mix.
You don't like it?
I'm deadly liking it, upon my word.
Is it true?
What?
You're not marrying Oindrila? Is it?
Oindrila,
come on. The guests are already here.
Yeah. Yes, she's.
Hi, Lalitha. Hi, Mriganko.
Hi.
I'm sorry I'm late. I was reading Snow by Pamuk. I just couldn't tear myself away from the book. Had Ma not gone to fetch me, I would have completely forgotten about this get-together.
I've never let Pamuk, but I've heard a lot about him. Oyon keeps talking about him.
Does he?
Yeah.
Well, he never told me that. When will he? We don't need each other nowadays.
Lalitha dear,
yes?
Would you kindly go to the kitchen and fetch the platter of kebabs, please?
Oh, of course.
Thank you. Thank you.
Excuse me.
Yes.
Ma?
Yes, dear.
Can I talk to Mriganko separately?
Oh.
We'll go into the dining room.
Well, whatever you have to say to each other, please do it fast. Now, don't make this another reason to insult me squarely, all right? Mriganko, please join Oindrila.
Yes.
My head feels something like a blob of jelly.
Why?
I can't think clearly. I need help.
You should go away from here, you know?
Why do you say that? I have so many things to do here.
Your newfound zeal for activism can prove to be dangerous, you know? Go away somewhere where you can do things that you've always wanted to do.
I want to do so many things here. I'm only becoming more and more marginalized every day.
You're a confused
woman. How can somebody allow such wrongs to go on?
You're a confused woman, Oindrila. There was a time when you wanted to follow your Ma's footsteps almost blindly. And today you want to oppose her, come what may, and in the process you're damaging yourself.
You don't have to bother about my hurt. You don't love me anymore. Do you? You don't tell me that anymore. You're so mean. You just dropped me like a piece of shit. Now that my Ma is on your side.
Now, what do you mean by that?
My Ma sees in you a writer worth investing.
So are you jealous?
It only shows the kind of person that you are.
hobnobbing into a person whom you hated until a few days ago. You have no standards of ethics. You've abandoned your friends at Fancy. If you had a conscience, you would feel remorse. Did you ever for a moment think why my ma is doing what she is doing to you? On the contrary, you beam a halo of pride. I feel so tiny having fallen in love with you. And more so for what happened today.
Get out of it then. I think we must join the party. It looks so odd keeping others waiting there.
When did you master all these bogus curtsies?
Vandula, you're just ranting at me, right? You've been drinking for too long now. Come on now, cheer up for old times. Say, come, come.
Oh, Indrila, have some red wine. I brought this bottle of Malbec just for you. And for heaven's sake, don't look so glum tonight.
Mriganko, would you like a glass of wine?
No, thank you. I don't drink.
Ah, I see.
It must be a beautiful night outside. Have you seen the stars, Mriganko? Have you seen them, Ma?
No.
I need to see them. I just need to see them. I'll go and come like a jet fly. You guys entertain yourselves. I'll pay a visit to the backyard. Probably the terrace. Enjoy.
Is Didi not feeling well?
Why do you say that?
She looks a bit pale.
Bodhi, I can understand the situation you're in.
What situation?
Oh, I was referring to Indrila.
Oh, no. Don't worry. It's only a passing phase. She feels for others, you see. She's a kind girl. And she'll see the truth gradually.
What is the truth, madam?
The truth, Mriganko, is that Oindrila, my daughter, will be the managing director of my new company.
I need to go to the washroom, if you'll please excuse me.
Sure. Lalita, my dear.
Yes?
You have anything to say to that?
No, just that I'd like to be a part of this new venture in whatever capacity you think is right.
Yes, of course, my dear. Don't be anxious. I'll take you on board when the time is right. But what about Oyun?
What about him? He's decided.
I see.
He'll quit as long as Mriganko is actually going to produce his film.
Well, did he discuss it with Mriganko?
Yes, he did.
Oh,
I see. Can I ask you something, Bodhi?
Yes.
When are you planning to organize Oindrila and Mriganko's wedding?
Halt! Halt! Halt!
What?
What's wrong?
What's happened? What has happened?
It's Oindrila.
What?
She's dead.
A few days later, in the evening, IPS officer Samaresh, a close friend of Deboshri, pays a visit.
Ah, Samaresh Babu. Ah, police department's findings.
Oh, madam, I can understand what you're going through.
Oh, thank you. I can only thank you from the bottom of my heart for your sincerest feelings. I've been absolutely cast inside an ocean of darkness. Such is my destiny. But please tell me if you found anything definite.
At one level, the death looks like an accident bordering on suicide.
Oh, how can you say that?
The autopsy report says that Oindrila was almost drowned in alcohol.
Really? But then she had only one glass of wine at the party that day.
The party was in the evening.
Yes.
She could have been drinking the whole day. In fact, one of her friends told us that she was a very regular drinker. While she had physical control, she lost mental balance. It happens to people suffering from depression.
Yes, yes, but have you found anything else?
Now we come to the most difficult part.
Which is?
I mean the wine that she had was spiked with at least 20 milligrams of a very strong sedative, which matches the sedative that she used to have regularly.
What?
She could have spiked her own drink.
Oh, and was this the cause of her death?
Actually, no. As she moved towards the backyard, she had to go down a flight of stairs.
Yes.
She tripped while going down and fell backwards.
Oh,
her neck hit one of the stairs so hard that her brainstem was badly damaged and caused instantaneous death.
Yes, yes, I know. But then, you know, the autopsy report, they've been leaked to the press and they're causing a real, real mess with it.
As you know, ma'am, the press is so invasive nowadays.
Yes.
However much we try, they beat us in our own game. A group of activists allegedly close to Aindrila are shouting murder from the rooftops. The press is slapping them up. Accident does not sell. Suicide sells. But not as much as murders do.
Oh, God, really? And I really need to think calmly now, you know?
I can understand that. I have an idea.
What?
Why don't we lie low in the case for some time?
Lie low.
The press is itching because it's a high-profile case.
Yes.
They want us to tell them something conclusive, but sensational enough to run their shop.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is, even if a conclusion is accident or suicide, they are implanting ideas of murder in the public mind.
But the question is, how do we lie low?
Say, if you yourself declare that you're not satisfied with the police investigations? And you want one of the experts to be deputed to the job to rule out any chances of foul play?
Yes, yes, it's true that I'm not satisfied with the police investigation at all. And I, for myself, do not rule out foul play. You see, everybody had a motive in killing Oindrila that night. You know about Devi Babu, Lalita and Oyon, but Mriganko could have killed her too.
Why would he kill Oindrila?
That's for you to find out. He could have easily pulled at her dress to cause her to trip. He's the guy who discovered her body, you know.
Madam, the point is, even if you open up the option of murder on her own to the press,
yes,
it will go ballistic in the first few days.
That's true.
But then slowly it will peter out. But if the police are further assigned to the task, the press will have its own means to find out about the investigation directly. And then we can't control the flow of information, even if it's required.
So, what are you suggesting, Shamuresh Babu?
You may request your contacts in the Home Department to depute a special expert on the job, who is essentially an outsider. This person will assist the police in the investigation.
Oh, and can this be done?
This can be done with a bit of push and pull. You have to make the police look pathetic in a few quarters. There is one Renuka Shanlal who can be assigned the job.
Who's she?
She was an IPS officer who now works in private.
I see.
Your advantage is the actual investigation will be absolutely insulated from the press. If there was any foul play, it will get caught by Renuka. No doubt about that. The heat the police has to face in the first 5-6 days will be easier to withstand. If we agree to the arrangement, we can start moving.
You've once again come up with a brilliant idea, Shamuresh Babu. The fact is, if somebody has actually murdered Oindrila, I would not like that person to go scot-free, you know. But an outsider like Renuka Shanlal will be of immense help. So let's get going.
This would mean Renuka would revisit the site.
Yes, of course.
Your house, make fresh inquiries and interviews with you and the others.
Oh, well, that shouldn't be any problem. Anything that's required to be done will be done. But do I need to talk to Renuka Shanlal once before?
Of course you can, if you wish to.
I'll tell her. I'll give you her mobile number.
Well, then please SMS it to me to my private number.
Madam?
Yes?
Before I go, I need to tell you something.
What?
There is something in the autopsy report which surprisingly never got leaked.
What?
Oindrila had sex 6 to 8 hours before she died. And it could not have been rape.
Oh, my God.
As per medical record, it was consensual.
The office of Renuka Sanyal. The interrogations begin.
May I come in?
Oh yes, please, Mrs. Lahiri.
Thank you.
Where were you during the day your daughter died?
Posed this question to me 2 times already, and I've already told you that I was in office. I reached office in the morning as usual, returned home at 6 p.m. Is there anything to prove otherwise? I mean, why would I lie to you on such a flimsy issue?
You're getting agitated, Mrs. Lahiri. Look, I'll ask you a question 100 times if that's required. There are witnesses who've told me that you left office just after lunch. You went home and left your home immediately and returned to your office thereafter.
Well, if people...
The question is, why should you lie to me on such a flimsy issue?
Well, if people are telling you this, then I must have left office and gone home. I mean, I could have, and I could have forgotten also. Normally, I would remember such a thing, but the stress is getting to me.
Do you ever leave your office for home midway?
No, normally I don't. I really can't imagine why I should have left for home that day. Do you suspect?
Oh, I'm not suspecting anything as yet. I'm just checking on the facts and the sequence of events.
I see.
Did you have an illicit relationship with Devi Babu?
No, absolutely not. We were good friends at one point of time, but never lovers. And even if we were, what relevance does this have to this case?
That's not for you to judge, Mrs. Lahiri. Were you or were you not lovers?
No, we were never lovers.
And were you happy with Oindrila's choice of her lover?
Initially, I was not happy, but later on, I gave in to my daughter's choice. You see, I was planning to launch Mriganko's book so that he looked decently successful and of some rank to be Oindrila's match. Otherwise, Oindrila would have suffered endless gossip.
And now, would you still publish his book that Oindrila is no more?
Oh, yes, of course I would. Mm-hmm. I've given him my word, so I'm going to keep it.
Did you keep yourself in the know-how of what was actually happening between Mriganko and Oindrila on a regular basis?
No, no, I won't say that. But if I saw Oindrila was unhappy, I would ask her.
Oindrila was unhappy.
Yes.
She was suffering from depression. She took sleeping pills regularly. She drank. Did you ever ask her why?
Of course, yes.
And what did she say?
Well, it wasn't as if we just had one conversation, you know. I can't narrate to you the whole transcript of what we talked about. But yes, she was extremely critical of the policies of our company. It was because she was confused, utterly confused.
And were you angry with her?
Yes and no.
Please explain.
Yes, because she was refusing to see my point of view. No, because she was a kind soul, and there were frustrated people diverting her attention. They were causing her to take a major embarrassment to our family, showing us up in poor light.
Did Mriganko have any view about your company?
No, not that I know of.
Well, having read a book by him, I would say that's a bit strange.
Why do you say that?
Because he seems to be sympathetic towards radical political ideology. At least, that's the kind of feeling I get. He strongly disapproves of agricultural land being traded away for industrial purposes.
Do you think Mriganko could have fueled such thoughts in Oindrila?
What do you think?
Well, Mriganko never discussed these issues in my presence.
Are you sure Mriganku loved Oindrila quite sincerely?
I would like to believe that, yes.
Did it ever occur to you that your relationship was going through turmoil?
Was it?
Did it ever occur to you?
No. Sometimes it did occur to me that Oindrila was disappointed in Mriganku. Only sometimes. I don't know why. It was just an impression.
Mm-hmm. And was Mriganku enraged about such issues?
Even if he was, I would not have known. You see, I had very little time to concentrate in the last 3-4 months, but whatever I might have thought, I knew they would patch up.
Mm. Well, that'll be all, Mrs. Lahiri. Please send Lalita in when you go out. Thank you.
Thank you.
Down. Yeah. Is it true that you tried to kill Oindrila a day after her 15th birthday?
Who told you that?
Whoever. Just answer me, please, because I'm asking the questions here, not you.
I pounced on her in retaliation. She abused my mother. Mm-hmm. She hit me with a badminton racket. You see this cut on my lip? It's because of that.
Mm-hmm. So you caught her sleeping? Suffocated her in sleep with a huge pillow. Do you call that retaliation, Lalita? You planned your work coolly. You did not act immediately in response.
I don't know how you'll judge it. Yes, the fact is that I was overcome with hatred, seeing her sleeping peacefully in silk linen while all of us suffered. It was possibly a momentary lapse of reason or something.
You talked of suffering. What kind of suffering?
Well, my JT ma, her mother, sidelined all of us in the family business.
All of us meaning your father?
Yes, my father.
Oh, was he not a wasted man? Partying, drinking, womanizing and gambling? Draining off all the family wealth with not a moment to spare for the grind of business?
That's not true. Fine, he did all of that, but much later, when he had lost everything. Jetima is a clever woman. With the help of Devi Babu, she became the big brother. Shouldered all responsibilities, took care of the whole company, gave them good positions apparently, paid them handsome salaries, and put Devi Babu in introducing them to drinking, gambling, and whoring around in parties. All this went to their heads.
And your ma, she never said anything?
Well, she did obstruct initially and also tried to reason with my father, but he wouldn't listen. Jethima is a very clever woman. She started blackmailing my father with photographs of him in compromising situations. Mm-hmm. Supplied by her man Friday. He understood the plot, but it was too late.
Why?
Well, he realized he had already signed on very dangerous papers that practically dethroned him, left us with no future in the family business. You know, Oyon's father also didn't help at all. He soon returned to his old ways. My mother also took to drinking, and she started drinking like a fish.
You nurture a deep-seated anger against your Jethima, Lalita, isn't that true?
How does a human being react to such humiliating circumstances?
Which means you're very angry, and it's further coupled because of your Jethima's expansion plans and her decision to make Oindrila the head of a new company, which would predictably outgrow the existing business many, many times over in the years to come.
No, she actually believes that we are beggars to be taken care of in a perfunctory manner that would not be troublesome for her.
So by we do you mean Oyon and you?
Yes.
Are you angry enough to cause harm to your Jethima, Lalita?
I would never harm Jethima.
But you do harbor plans of harming your Jethima, right?
No, that's not true.
Oh, you would have fought tooth and nail to get at birth in the new company and lost no opportunity to beat Oindrila in the race.
No, it's not untrue that I would have liked to beat Oindrila in the race, but it was an unfair race, madam. Oindrila was already nominated the winner.
So you remove her and everything becomes so easy.
I would never do anything like that.
Mm-hmm. What do you think of Mriganku?
I don't think much of him, madam.
Who Oh, really? But you've met him twice at the Park Street Barista in the last 2 days for about 4 to 5 hours in totality, no?
You're keeping unnecessary tabs on me. Yes, I met Mriganko. He asked me to read his manuscript and offer my views.
And you've offered your views?
Yes, I had strong views.
Oh, really? Like?
Well, like his new style of writing. Letting a straight cut story. I believe he hasn't mastered it enough.
Did he ever talk to you about Oindrila?
No.
Was Oindrila very seriously involved with the activists? How serious was her rift with the company policies? Did you enjoy this new conflict, Lalita?
Too many questions at a time, don't you think? I think she was sad. This sadness was slowly driving her into rebellion. Look, I don't support Oindrila's views. Yes, her conflict with JT Mao would ruin everything that I'd dreamed to rule one day.
Was the relationship between Oindrila and Mriganko dying?
How would I know?
Is Mriganko charmed by you?
I don't think so. He seems to be a very dispassionate writer.
Are you charmed by Mriganko?
Not at all.
Tell me, Lalita, what time did you reach your Jetima's house the day Oindrila died?
I think it was around 7 in the evening.
7?
Yeah.
All right, yes, that'll be all for the moment. As you go out, please send Mriganko.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. Thank you. Sit down. Your relationship with Oindrila was on the decline, Mriganko, I was told. Is that true?
Our relationship was complex. It would be difficult to reply to your question in a straight-cut manner. In a certain manner, we had grown apart. But I think we still had a lot of love and respect for each other.
Was the passion missing in the last 6 to 7 months?
Yes, you can say that.
Why? Because you were in love with some other woman?
Not at all. Oindrila was busy in her own work, and I was busy writing my last novel.
You never stood by Oindrila in a fight against her mother, like giving moral and emotional support to her?
I did all that up to a point. But she wanted to do it all alone. Sometimes, I believe that was the reason that we grew apart.
I suspect you're a dangerous liar, Mriganko.
Please talk to me politely, Renuka, madam.
By the way, did you sleep with Oindrila in the last 6 to 7 months?
It's a very private query. I may decide not to answer such invasive questions.
You may. The choice is yours. But it'll have grave consequences on you. If you answer and you lie, that will have graver consequences.
I think I last slept with Oindrila 3 to 4 months back.
Never after that?
Never after that.
Why do you think Oindrila lodged her battle against her mother all alone?
I think she loved her mother most intensely at one level. And at another, she hated her equally.
And you supported Oindrila's causes?
Yes, I still do. You've got to read my body of work to understand that.
Then why are you getting your book published by her mother?
Come on. She's not a demon. Even Oindrila felt good about it. How can a writer reach a wider audience without commercial support, you tell me?
Why is it that Debashree agreed to open up a publishing business all of a sudden? This was never her core area of business. What kind of a relationship do you share with Debashree?
We stay at a respectful distance of each other. Yes, after she decided to venture into publishing and propose that she'll publish my work, I became more frank with her, that's it.
Frank?
Yes.
As in?
Like we talk about many issues. Earlier we didn't talk much. She didn't find me a suitable boy for her daughter.
So you stuck to your job of impressing your would-be mother-in-law, huh? Why?
Her mother's approval of me was central to Oindrila. I didn't want to displease her, now can I go?
No, you cannot. Just sit down. Tell me something. Did you go to Oindrila's house sometime around early afternoon the day she died?
Yes.
Why?
Oindrila wanted to hear a few chapters of my novel.
And did you read out your novel to Hamrikanko?
Yes, I did the first two chapters. Mm-hmm. It was yet to be finished at that point in time.
How long were you there?
Maybe for 2 hours.
Mm-hmm. And was Oindrila drinking, listening to your novel?
Yes, she was.
You never objected to her alcoholism?
I did. I was in deep anguish. Her mother and I made many efforts to counsel her, but she wouldn't listen.
Do you think Oindrila was murdered?
Yes.
Who murdered Hamrikanko?
Devi Babu, of course. That smart cookie. I saw him spiking her drink.
Devi Babu.
Yes.
Right, as you go out, please send Devi Babu in. Thank you.
Thank you.
Devi Babu, please.
Thank you.
You've been a dutiful slave to the Lahiris for a very long time, Devi Babu.
Yes, madam. It's been more than 30 years now. You put it correctly. A dutiful slave indeed.
But how come you landed up in such a small family-run business? Like, it was very small when you joined, even by standards of that time. You were academically inclined, Devi Babu. You could have pursued other more attractive opportunities.
Well, Bodhi's father-in-law was a very close friend of the then head of the chemistry department in Presidency College. Mm-hmm. He demanded for his best student, and I was selected. And so I'm sitting before you answering your questions.
You mind answering them?
Oh, no, not at all. I want to know the truth for myself.
The truth? The truth is that you people were plotting against Oindrila's takeover of the new plant.
Look, I don't know what you mean by you people. Yes, it's a fact that I didn't agree to Bodhi's succession plan for the new plant. Well, not before Oindrila was ready for the job. You know, it's a tragedy that she had to die untimely. She would have succeeded in the long run.
You mean in destroying Debashree's vision for the new plant? Because that is what Oindrila had set out for herself.
Oh, yes, she was steadfast in her conviction. She was dangerous enough to create a lot of problems in the business. But somehow she was bitter with life. I don't know why. Her persona changed all of a sudden in the last 1 year.
You were in love with Debashree at one point of time, right? You wanted to marry her.
Yes, yes. No, but that was a long time back. Debashree never agreed to the marriage. That would disrupt business. I mean, her comprehensive takeover of the business.
Yet you helped her at every corner.
I did. Mm. Debashree had a fantastic quality of involving you in a battle. I was smitten by that apart from my love for her.
You felt betrayed when she refused to employ your daughter?
You know, I felt like I had wasted my life assisting a useless woman. But there was no way that I could have changed my life then.
You think you've been suitably compensated, Devi Babu?
For what?
Your dutiful slavery, of course.
Yes. Well, Debashree saw to it that I was compensated one way or the other. This company would not have been what it is today without me. Mm. No way. And I did want my daughter to carry on the legacy with Oindrila, Lolita, and Ion. And I thought that was a valid idea. But she made a mistake.
What?
You see, she suffers from the paranoia of immortality. She only wanted Oindrila as a puppet through whom she could continue her empire. But her judgment of Oindrila was wrong. Oindrila, in spite of everything, had a soul.
You know what, Devi Babu? You're a smart ass. But you failed to impress me with your cultivated speech. Look, I'm not saying what you said is untrue. Oh, tell me one thing, though. The day Oindrila died, you brought her a bottle of Malbec, right?
Oh, yes, she loved Malbec. I wanted to see her happy. You know, I could see her drowning. And Debashree had told me in the morning that we must do everything in our capacity to keep her happy that evening.
So, Debashi instructed you to bring the wine.
No. I suggested it on my own that I'll bring her a bottle of Malbec.
And did she react when she heard your proposal?
No, I don't think so. She was happy to hear that I remembered her preference in wine.
Who served the wine that evening?
I don't remember really.
Who filled up your wine glass?
I can't remember.
Did you go to Debashree's house in the afternoon?
No.
Did you go in the direction of that house in the afternoon?
Well, I could have.
Tell me yes or no, Debi Babu.
Well, all right, yes.
Why did you go there?
Oh, I was just crossing that locality on my way to the office from a professional meeting.
Did you find something odd about the house?
No, absolutely not.
Did you see somebody's car parked outside the house? Did you see somebody going in or out of the house?
Well, I think I saw a car. It actually belongs to Debashree, but was being used by Mriganko.
And then you came back to office. What did you do after that?
I had a meeting.
So before attending this meeting, did you talk to Debashree?
I think I did.
You didn't tell her about the car that you saw outside her house?
Well, I could have mentioned it in passing.
Did you or did you not?
Well, yes, I did.
And Debashree immediately left office after talking to you?
I really do not know. You can ask her.
Now that Oindrila is no more, what do you think happens to the succession plan in the business?
I don't know. You need to ask Debashree.
Don't you think her control over her business will be substantially weakened by Oindrila's absence?
That's because of the trauma she's going through.
Did you find anything odd during the party, Debi Babu?
Yes. You know, Mriganko and Oindrila were mad at each other. Oh, there's something else that I need to tell you.
What?
From the corner of my eye, while I was passing through the central corridor on my way to the washroom, I saw Mriganko mixing something in a wine glass. Well, I didn't attach too much importance to it then. I just thought he was designing his drink. But I just can't believe he was planning to kill Oindrila.
Why would he do that?
Well, you are the investigator, not me. Find it out for yourself.
Yes, I will. Thank you, Debi Babu.
Thank you.
That'll be all. After you.
Another day, back to the Lahiri home.
Ah, Renuka.
Yes.
Please, come in and sit down.
Thank you.
Well, now that you've talked to everyone many times over, explored the site of death and almost crammed up all evidences and reports, as I'm told, are you nearer to the truth?
Truth. That's a difficult word to handle. Yes. I think I'm nearer to the truth.
So then, should I assemble all the possible suspects in my house? I suppose you would like to deliver your concluding lecture as it happens in all detective novels.
For the moment, I would like to talk to you only, Debashree.
Oh.
At this stage at least.
I see.
Later you may decide how you would like to get this concluded. In a classical detective novel, everything falls in place, you know. The murderer, the evidences, the alibis, the circumstances, the methods, and the motive. I mean, in the end, they have to. But life is not as determinate as reflected in a detective novel. Will you agree with me on this?
You mean to say that at times the truth and the lie are inseparable?
Yes, something very close.
See.
Were you very ambitious from your early childhood?
Oh, yes, I was.
It's so difficult to imagine a brilliant girl of 16 married off to an otherwise uninspiring man.
Well, you know, I wanted to escape my father, so marriage seemed to be the only reasonable solution.
I believe although your motivation to escape your circumstances was very intense, you made a considered choice in marriage, even at such a tender age. You weighed your circumstances of how far you would progress in such a family after marriage, in making an independent and prosperous career.
Well, there are no ways to prove such matters of intention, except for words of one side versus the other.
And words in such cases cloud the truth, you know. Are we now going to devote our time in arguing the futility of words and language in deducing the truth?
Debashree, as I've interviewed many people in due course of this investigation, I've gathered a general understanding of the main events and the principal characters. Yet I've not understood or come to terms with many fundamental things.
Like?
Like, how deep can somebody excavate an abyss within the bowels of this earth and live inside it happily, drowned in vain glory? How dark should an abyss get filled with its endless operations of greed and lust before its chief architect runs for some sunshine for a change?
I don't understand your questions.
Do you ever feel any remorse for having committed multiple crimes to further your enterprise? To amass wealth more than half of which lies unseen and untracked, huh? These are crimes for which you worked in partnership with representatives of the government, and at times you formed shadowy cartels with your competitors to pull off your bluff.
Tell me one thing, you naive political detective. Is there a way by which industry can run exceedingly profitably without breaking laws? I created wealth. I created jobs. I changed the decaying landscape of many a place. You must know that.
Oh, you can shout yourself hoarse to boost your ego, Mrs. Lahiri. But you know what you did? You snatched. You killed. If required, you produced inferior goods. You overbilled and you didn't pay up your taxes.
Well, I'm not the only one. You haven't discovered anything, you know, new.
True. In spite of all this, you loved your daughter most dearly. You sincerely wanted her to inherit your businesses, even when she was planning to dismantle you. Yet, you killed her by poisoning her drink.
You think so?
I'm sure about that, Debashree. You were ferociously enraged when you found Mriganko and Oindrila making love during the afternoon the day she died.
What? You know, but Mriganko was a bad influence on Oindrila, you know.
Was he a good influence on you? He and you were like animals in heat. I've seen the transcript of some of the SMSs exchanged between you both. You snatched Mriganko from Oindrila. Oindrila loved Mriganko most sincerely, and her life was shattered when she found him withdrawing from those basic values for which she regarded him her hero. Her love was laced with dreams. Your love. That was based on clarity of hedonism.
Why did Mriganko make love to Oindrila that day? How could Oindrila successfully drive him to bed? Do you think she loved Mriganko still?
There are no clear-cut answers to these questions. But the fact is that this love scene drove you mad. You returned to your office, and you had the audacity of procuring a bulk of sedatives from the office pharmacy. I found Oindrila's own stock lying evidently unutilized. How? How can you insult another's intelligence to this extent? Tell me! You knew Oindrila was drinking during the day, so when you mixed the sedatives, you were sure of meeting your objective. Where did you throw the empty foils? In the garden bin. The police sealed the house just after midnight. Were you aware that the foils would carry your fingerprints, Debashree? You almost forgot to take any precautions in your excitement.
A momentary lapse of reason.
No, not momentary. You killed her in the evening, Debashree. But you planned her death during the day. Your training has taught you one simple thing. When you can't farm or cattle, just kill your competitor. In love, you considered your daughter to be a competitor. You were so driven by sexual jealousy.
No, no, no.
Why did you kill Mriganko, huh?
I was addicted to him. I was so agitated with Oindrila's fury of activism. At times, I dreamt of having her vanished from my life.
My belief is, had she not been ditched in love, she would not have pursued activism. You brought ruin upon yourself by destroying her love, Debashree. But Mriganko, he was not worthy of her love.
It's not as if I didn't try to kill my love for Mriganko. I did, but I failed.
Like you could never come out of your abyss of greed, You could never come out of your abyss of lust.
No, no, it was not just lust alone, Renuka. There was also love in it. I'm carrying Mriganko's child. I feel it's Oindrila who's inside me.
I don't believe you could go this far. Are you truly disintegrating or putting on an act, Debashri? Are you carrying this child to prove your point of love?
No, why should I do that?
To cajole me, to change my verdict publicly. So, if you could make an impression of some sincerity and sensitivity, your gamble was that I would reiterate the original finding of the police that Oindrila had committed suicide out of sympathy for you.
Such things never crossed my mind. Tell me, if I let Oindrila live, will she let me live?
Is there a way to conclude this without a doubt? I'll submit my report and my findings comprehensively, Debashri. It will speak the truth as I know it.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for this brilliant performance by Spotlight. Could I have a round of applause? Mriganko as Zahid Hussain. Oindrila Pratigya Ghosh. Debashri Rita Roy. Lalita Bhavna Jhingan. Devi Babu, Pradeep Mitra, Oyon Arush Sengupta, Shomaresh Odhip Guptu, Renuka Rajashri Gagar. Ladies and gentlemen, backstage was Archana Swaika and Poonam Singh. Lights Uttyo Jana, sound Niloy Panchal. Thank you so much, Spotlight. You were incredible this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to briefly thank you. Thank few individuals who made this evening possible. I would like to extend my heartfelt thank you to Mr. Swarup Nanda, CEO of Lead Start Publishing, for publishing Abyss and for this magnificent evening. Miss Oindrila Dutt, founder Open Doors, a big thank you for your tireless effort and support. And as Shabunoda said earlier this evening, today would not have been possible without you. Thank you from all of us, Oindrila. May I ask Miss Choyonika Chakraborty, writer, publisher of Boichitro, to please come up and felicitate Oindrila. Oindrila, a small thank you from all of us. Please put your hands together for Oindrila Dutt. Miss Ruma Chakraborty, senior English faculty of Sushila Birla High School, you were magnificent today. You conducted the interview very eloquently. Please come up for a token of appreciation from us. Choyonika Chakraborty will hand it over to you. Ladies and gentlemen, for this lovely lady, please put your hands together. I would also like to thank Mr. Prithviraj Chaudhary, Managing Director of Nava Private Limited, for the brilliant and extraordinary creative communication for the event. Thank you, Prithviraj. Now, ladies and gentlemen, for Mr. Sabarna Roy, a big thank you to you for writing Abyss, for your patience, for your support, and for
all that you have done to make this evening possible. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for the author, Mr. Sabarna Roy. I would also like to thank T2 for being our media partner. A big thank you to The Telegraph for being here this evening. I would like to thank Mr. Sushruta Sarkar, director, partner of Ahava Communications, for so effectively organizing and executing the event. And to JW Marriott, the entire team of JW Marriott, thank you so much for all the arrangements this evening. A big thank you to JW Marriott. Thank you, Niharika Chakraborty, for being the perfect hostess this evening. I would also like to thank Mr. Anuj Kumar Maurya, Mr. Boshunto Bera, Mr. Orun Dotto, and Kostub Roy Chaudhary for logistics and coordination. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, this evening has been a grand success because of you, because of each one of you being present today. You have been a wonderful audience. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Abyss and the wonderful performance today. Thank you so much. We will, before we throw the dinner and the cocktails open for you, ladies and gentlemen, just two final things. Mr. Sabarna Roy's books are available. If you want them, please get the copies signed. They are right there. And secondly, I would like to call a few people without which the evening would not have happened. We would like to just give a token of appreciation. May I call upon Pradeep Mitro and Rita Roy? May I request Ms. Usha Uttup to please felicitate them. Ladies and gentlemen, you can do better than that. Come on. Could a representative from Lead Start Publishers please come up to collect the token of appreciation for Mr. Swarup Nanda, CEO, Lead Start Publishing. May I request Ms. Oindrila Dutt to please come up. Please, Oindrila. Ladies and gentlemen, Oindrila Dutt. May I ask Ms. Ruma Chakraborty to please come up? Mr. Prithviraj Chaudhary, please come up. Mr. Sabarna Roy and Mr. Sushruta Sarkar on behalf of Ahava Communications. Prithviraj Chaudhary being felicitated. Thank you, Prithviraj. And Sushruta Sarkar from Ahava Communications.
Sengupta, ladies and gentlemen, the one who really, really has worked so hard to put this evening together, along with Sushruta. And while that's happening, ladies and gentlemen, at the entrance right here are the books, and that is someone who writes with real Catholic taste. So do see if you'd like to browse through anything and pick it up. The bar's open at the back, your liquid refreshments and your dinner await. Enjoy the evening, whatever is left of it. Thank you. Thank you for being here.